this is, as I joke with people, this is 2013. This is not 2001. We are in a different era nowadays, and there are some sort of bandwidth issues now happening.
Yeah, there is. Trust me, there is. I mean, it's like a bandwidth war almost.
Yes.
Okay, so we have been talking about radiation and a potential fallout or what could happen in the United States if we in the U.S. Suffered one. But again, what is to say that could not happen in the United States? We try to pride ourselves, of course, on technology, on building codes, all this. But who is to say that even Hanford, here in Washington State, that it would never erupt into a ball of smoke or flames, fumes coming out of it?
Yeah, well, Hanford, Washington, as everybody will know, let me just remind them, it is basically in the southeast corner of Washington State. So essentially, you're at a moderate earthquake risk there. Let me put that into numbers. With about 80% probability over the next, let's say, 10 years, there's going to be a 5.5 to a 6.5 Richter scale earthquake in that neck of the woods. And at a 6.5, which is much different, it's 32 times the size of a 5.5, you are going to see quite a bit of damage. And we are racing against time. And everybody knows the situation in Hanson, in Hanford, Washington. There have been legal delays. There were issues with the workers there not being of the right kind to fix it. There was money allocated to clean up this extreme radiation area. Don't forget, by the way, that Hanford, Washington is the 10th most radioactive place on the planet. If you Google 10 top most radioactive places on the planet, Hanford, Washington comes up as number 10. Obviously now Fukushima is number 1, Chernobyl is 2, and there are places in England and in Kyrgyzstan and in Russia that obviously take other spots. But the problem is this, Robert, what Fukushima has done is it's opened up a lot of people's eyes and minds. We're going through this awakening, and I'm going to get attacked by the nuclear people that say everything's safe, but the reality is that nuclear power is not safe. If you tally all of the radioactive and nuclear situations since Fukushima in the U.S., they have happened in over 18 states with over 30 incidences due to floods, due to power outages, and due to solar flares. Well, and the point is, Robert, there has been radioactive leaks by reactors even in the past 1 month.
Well, this is maybe a bizarre question, but I know that there are conspiracy theorists that are out there. I don't know if even some of our viewers are conspiracy theorists or not, but do you think, in your, speaking for yourself, do you feel maybe that the United States government as a whole has covered up a lot of the stuff that is so harmful to the American populace, including radiation or the potential for a radiation fallout?
I'm going to give you a very easy answer, and it's what I call anti-politician. The answer to your question is yes. The U.S. government has covered up a lot of stuff that is harming U.S. citizens and otherwise people that want to become U.S. citizens on American soil. Is that a very clear answer for you?
It is. But, I think it's shocking for a lot of people, Doctor, to know and to not just to see what happened in Japan. If that wasn't bad enough, insult upon top of injury, and now the plumes floating over into the U.S. But whereas the United States has actually more nuclear capabilities, radiation capabilities than Japan does. So, you know, earthquakes and all this, okay, we can't prevent those, obviously, but surely something can be done to retrofit the buildings that exist and or create new guidelines for structures that would not be hurt. Say again. All right, folks, for, you know, this is bizarre. It really is bizarre. I've never, ever had a call up and down the way this is. It's a bit bizarre. So, folks, I know that he's frozen. We're going to go back, folks, to Turkey. So give me a minute, and we'll see what we can do to get this figured out and fixed. So hang on, folks.
Okay,
doctor. You know what? We may end up just okay. Well, we can. You know, we're just gonna have to battle this out, right? That's all that I know. That
I think your viewers are very patient, especially with the amount of information that we're covering, and whatever's causing this. I mean, I have a 50 megabit per second up. Or down, sorry, so and a 5 megabit per second up, so it should not be affected.
That's great. You know, honestly, I have not a clue what is...
I wonder if I've lost you.
Well, you know what, folks? Hey, there we go all over again, and I don't understand this. This is absolutely ridiculous. Okay, folks, let us go back to Turkey and let us see what's going on in Turkey as we speak, folks. This, again, is a live shot of Turkey. And give me just a second, folks.
Hello?
Hey, okay, good. I've got you here. Did you want to get that shot of me on Skype?
Sure. Let me actually capture it. Let me go into my contacts. Actually, I don't have a photo of you on Skype.
Okay. All right. Let's do. What do you want to go ahead now anyway?
Absolutely. Maybe. Let's just go for it. I think while we have the opportunity to do so.
Okay. Good. And then everybody can see the video, and then they can hear me too.
Correct.
Jolly
okay,
good.
So
all right,
before
well, let's get straight to it then.
Absolutely. Sorry, but I am appalled. I really am. But thank you for giving me your number so I could actually call you.
Right. Well, you know, this has happened before when I was in another country and I was on another radio show. And I, you know, talk about conspiracy theories, you'll probably get one of your viewers saying it's just absolutely mad. But we have to think in the realm of possibilities of interruptions. And they do happen, and they have happened for various purposes, because some people don't want certain information to get out. And I think we just have to maybe leave it right there.
Correct. Okay, so, you know, we were talking before about earthquakes in the United States. We've seen earthquakes happen in various parts of the country already in the last
right.
2 years that haven't had one in the last 100 years. But as a populace, what can Americans actually do to be prepared for an all-out disaster if it ever happened or if it came down to that?
Well, the probability of an all-out, you know, nuclear disaster in the U.S. from a reactor going offline is less than 1%. However, if it did happen, it would basically be a black swan event, and the government would essentially do what they did in Fukushima. They would issue enough sort of potassium iodide to a population around a 30-mile radius of a nuclear reactor. And, you know, people would basically either move away from that reactor, or they would stay if they did not have the ability financially or otherwise. But I think the bigger thing is all about preparation. People in the United States, compared to many other countries in China or especially Europe, are woefully ill-prepared. People think that the U.S. government is just going to come to their sort of, you know, their assistance or their pleas or their calls for help, you know, within a 24, 48-hour period. And during a black swan event, we saw that with Katrina and we saw that with Hurricane Sandy. It does not happen. FEMA, as well prepared as they may be, obviously they have a lot of holes. I call them the Swiss cheese agency, because really they are doing more to protect themselves and with a future agenda than they are the American population. And again, this is very new to a lot of people, because many people believe that the U.S. government is there to protect them. Well, I have news for everybody. It is not. Basically, most people are on their own. And if, God forbid, there is a black swan event, from what I can see, connecting different planetary disasters from all around the world, it is prudent, especially if a mother or father or adult in general has children or other people that are dependent on him or her, to have 2 to 4 weeks of food and filtered water, as well as any other supplies, because being prudent puts you in a better position, an advantage with a competitive edge. Businesses do this, government agencies do this, but again, if people are woefully ill-prepared, when something does happen, and God forbid it does, but we all know with probability these things do happen, I want people to be alert and aware and prepared. If that's the one message that we broadcast out tonight to be awakened, to be alert, to be on the in the know. That's the main objective.
Well, one of the chatters, OWS Rocks, in the chat room, asked the question, do you think that a polar shift is coming?
Well, it's already occurring. And it's a great question, Robert. And that person that asked that question is obviously more in the know than most. And I don't mean that in a nasty way. I want people to wake up and realize that our planet is an electromagnetic being. In other words, it inhales and exhales like we do. There are periods of chaos and there are periods of quiet. You go back and you research the cycles. But the pole shift is already happening. The magnetic north is moving very fast now towards Siberia. And when it gets to a certain point, probably in 2 years or less, there will be a series of large earthquakes, especially in the northern hemisphere. And that will result in major climatic cooling. Because of the interplay or the interdynamic play of atmospheric and oceanic factors, and that is going to cause impacts into agriculture.
What about he brings up OWS Rocks in the chat. He brings up the ice age. Do you think that this is going to immediately or could immediately bring us back into an ice age era?
Well, obviously, since 2008, the planet has been cooling. Even the Met Office, which is the equivalent of the National Weather Service in the United States, basically came out with an article this past February and said there has not been any global warming, there has not been any increase in temperature globally since 1998. Look, you're going to get a lot of people out there very mad with this because the whole thing with global warming is it's a carbon taxation scam. Everybody sort of, you know, produces carbon dioxide, and the Western governments and many governments around the world need extra revenue. So why not, let's say, come up with a brilliant plan of tax our carbon dioxide output? And essentially, since 2008, anybody that's in the UK or in Western Europe knows that the last few years have been abominably cool in the summer and wet and chilly and cold and snowy in the winters. And snow has come all the way down to Libya. It's been snowing, accumulating snow in each winter down in Libya. And it's been the coldest winter since 1962. And just, you know, 2 years ago, Robert, the December, I think it was 2011 or 2010, it was the coldest five-week period in 400 years. So things are changing. The Gulf Stream is shifting further southward. The jet stream in the Arctic winter is coming further south, and it's allowing more Siberian masses, air masses, to come into Europe.
Now, do you think? Let's look at the southern hemisphere. Is the South Pole actually moving right alongside of the North Pole, and it's actually shifting, or is it just the North Pole that is actually shifting? Sort of like the world is splitting completely apart.
Yeah, essentially, the southern hemisphere is not going through the same sort of magnetic chaos that the northern hemisphere has got. You need, in order to have a pole shift, you need to have the imbalance. And the imbalance is caused by the North Pole magnetics going much more wildly off kilter than the southern hemisphere. But, you know, sort of take note that once the magnetic acceleration becomes off kilter in the northern hemisphere, the southern hemisphere will follow suit shortly thereafter.
Well, this is a yet another interesting parallel, I guess, if there were any parallels. Let us maybe temporarily focus our attention on the attitudes, the mindset of the people in Japan just prior to the horrific earthquake that they had that resulted in the radiation fallout, the disaster that they had on their hands. Are you seeing that same type of mindset within Americans today or any other place around the globe, as it were, just prior to what happened in Japan?
I've lived in Japan, Robert, and the mindset there is very, very different. People have a sort of a value system that respects each other as sort of comrades, even though they may be strangers. And they also have an elder system whereby the youngsters or even younger adults will respect the decisions brought about through collected knowledge and wisdom of the elders. It's like that in the native Indian culture as well as many other societies and cultures around the world. And I think that those cultures obviously have the better outcomes during disasters. However, the Japanese citizens rely too much on the government. They are not very, as a whole, you know, as a sort of a population, if you look at it as a herd, they are not independent thinkers. So one will make a decision and everybody will follow. So if that decision is made by the government, then everybody will follow the government. And this is why the Japanese have not sort of rallied up against the government and asking for answers. If TEPCO says that, you know, there's no radiation, the Japanese will say, "Hai, so nan desu ne." And then so basically, you know, meaning yes. So basically in America, the population is very independent thinking. We will question the government as much as we can, but we will not, in many cases during a disaster, act cohesively. And so what I'm asking is that most people develop a trust network. And I think you're going to be hearing that phrase more. And it's sort of combining psychology and disaster risk management and the ability to help each other by developing a community trust network so that in the time of, God forbid, a black swan or natural disaster, people know what they can do as a group to help mitigate the disaster.
I have two questions for you. One of them from Crusader, 1954, saying, ask Dr. Atkins what he thinks about extraction of the hydrocarbon and fracking. What do you think of that?
Wow, we're asking a lot of dangerous questions tonight, aren't we? So,
that's the nature of the folks that are.
That's good because, look, I think the other second thing that's going to come out of this show is that we ought to be able to speak bluntly. I mean, we're talking about major issues here that have huge, wide-ranging impacts on a population. And these people, Robert, you know, with due respect to them, are asking these questions because they're not getting the answers at the local or official government level.
Right.
And so the answer simply is that if you frack enough in one area, or if you frack too deep for the in an unstable sedimentation area, you are going to see detrimental effects downstream. Let me say this. It is no question in my mind that all of the sinkholes that are happening in Louisiana, in Florida, in China, in Russia, and in all many other countries of the world, yes, it's due in part to the shifting magnetics of the Earth as well as the Sun. But technologically, or shall we say techno-anthropologically, meaning what we are doing to the world, forget the carbon dioxide. That is the big lie. What's really happening is the technology that we're using, the fracking, the HAARP, that is the energy that's going up into the ionosphere, that is what is affecting the Earth.
OWS asked the question as well. Interesting question. How many cities do you know of that are literally underwater, physically, as a result of potentially of the poles shifting?
Well, we're going to see many more large storms. We're just starting to see the beginning of the extreme events. Look at what's happening right now in Europe. Germany, Austria, Switzerland, the Czech Republic, it just came out today that they are under a 500-year flood. Also, the EF5 Oklahoma tornado. It was the widest tornado ever recorded. Can you tell the passion in my voice here? I mean, are people getting it? The connections are just incredible. And so the number of cities that are going to be experiencing the number of storms that will put more and more floods into more and more cities, this is going to become a sort of a planetary risk epidemic. We're going to start seeing all kinds of flooding events. Look at the Mississippi. I mean, February, Robert, it was at a 65-year drought level low. They were blasting with dynamite the number of rocks into the Mississippi because the barges couldn't get through. And I was advising clients how in 3 months or less, come this May or April, and it did in fact happen, how we're getting record-breaking flooding. Right now, as we speak, there is levees being broken along the Mississippi. Well, so more and more places are going to go underwater.
There was, actually, as of today, Anton, Missouri, a levee broke there. 10 feet of water expected from what I had understood. There was it had broke back when I read the news story. 2 hours prior to that, it actually broke, and the water had already risen 2 feet, so about a foot an hour.
Now, yeah, absolutely. By the way, let me just review one thing. There were a couple of very, very strong, record-breaking tornadoes in Oklahoma.
Yes.
It is very difficult right now to tell which tornado was seen multiple times. In other words, if I've got a person to the south of the tornado and a person to the northeast of the tornado and a person to the northwest of the tornado, and then there are other tornadoes coming within that triangulated area, it's difficult right now for the National Weather Service to say which tornado was the biggest. But I can say that in the last 1 week or the last 10 days, one of those tornadoes in Oklahoma was the widest tornado ever recorded in history, that is in modern times. And the reason was because the magnetics from the sun were streaming in so fast, it charged up the atmosphere to unbelievable records.
Now, one last question that I have for you about HAARP. Do you think that physical element, that physical place, has any bearing at all on the weather, the nuclear fallouts, the earthquakes, and if so, how?
Well, let's do another classic Simon Says answer for the viewers, because nobody likes any word beginning with B and ending with S. The answer is, Robert, the answer is this, that HAARP is an electromagnetic tool that causes ionospheric disturbances and tectonic plate movements as it ripples back towards the planet. Let's make no mistake, the establishment, whoever you want to call that, the government, some people say the Illuminati, I don't want to get off kilter here, but the people that are in charge of these technological toys, they are very dangerous for the planet. And essentially, all of those billions of volts that are projected into the ionosphere, they harm the electromagnetic aura of the planet. And when they bounce down again, they cause ionospheric reverberation. Look that up, ionospheric reverberation. It is both light and sound, radiation and electromagnetics, and it splits into the Earth, causing earthquakes. It is a weapon, and it was made top secret for many years, and now there are multiple ones around the world. And you know the Paracibo astronomy area in Puerto Rico, that is being converted into another semi-harp area.
OWS has one last question for you in the chat. Hey, he's pretty good. He says, can you, doctor, give some insights on the animal die-off, like birds, fish, etc.?
Absolutely. This is caused by massive methane particulates that are being released suddenly from the different areas of the world. There have been many of these. They usually happen over water because it's easier for the methane to leak, if you will, or push up through water, and therefore it will essentially first stun and then kill schools of fish or dolphins. It will actually change the magnetics in that area. But it's also happened over land, and it will kill flocks of birds. Now, people will say, well, why aren't people dying? Or, you know, why aren't 20 million people dropping all of a sudden during these methane areas? Well, guess what? We have a higher electromagnetic being, or we have a higher magnetic center than those birds. All right, so it's not going to kill us, but I can tell you this. It is going to harm us health-wise, and it can actually change the functioning of cellular respiration so that there's many more diseases happening. What? And so essentially, in a nutshell, Robert, you are going to get these methane releases happening more and more as the planet shifts.
Well, doctor, I tell you what, the chat room right now is exploding. Very good questions, and people like you a lot. And they're hoping, crossing their fingers, as me, that you will soon on another show come back and do another show with me.
Well, why don't we take a vote and ask the viewers? That's what we're here for. We're trying to wake up people and try to connect in a positive spiritual way as well as a scientific way. Ask them, when they'd like me to come back. Do you have another 5 minutes so we can do sort of the encore of the hour since we had those interruptions, or is your schedule tight?
Yeah, no. Let's do the encore of the hour. And people are saying, hey, have you back already. But, I tell you, a lot of the things, doctor, that you've been talking about, is a lot of the stuff that we've already been talking about within our own peer groups, within our own media, for a long time. And you have been able to hit the nail on the head, if anybody ever has. And people think that you're very interesting.
Well, I appreciate that. I think, look, let me be humble, and I always plan to be humble, is that it's not often, this is what I'm told, it's not often that somebody will have a certain amount of courage, a certain amount of knowledge, and a certain amount of humility to come out and speak spiritually and scientific, human being to human being,
right,
and say the truth. Robert, I've had almost, I've had two near-death experiences. I wake up each morning with a lot of passion, and I love to tell people, live your life in joy. And so I get passionate when I see people that are blocking the truth. And I educated myself for many years to learn to how to connect the different parts of risk that are going on around the world and predict it outward. And we've had phenomenal success. And I think that we need to spread the need to connect and to spread the need to tell the truth so that we can all benefit collectively.
You know, I do too. I really do. And everybody in the chat, you know, I could sit here and do a full 2-hour show. That's the typical talk show that I do is a 2-hour show. But you are so in depth with a lot of questions and answers. There isn't with some things that we've talked about, you barely touched the tip of the iceberg on it, if that. But the viewers that we have are very intellectual, which I think is great.
Yes.
And they want to hear even more from you in an upcoming interview. So if you are game for that, trust me, I am as well.
Well, let's do this. As I say, I will respectively listen to the chorus of the audience. And if they would like me to come back, then I am a civil servant at their beckoning. And I will come back and I will take as many questions as we need to over that 2-hour period in science, in natural medicine, in spirituality, in multi-dimensions, and other things that maybe the establishment is not telling us. Look, I'll end with this, Robert. I am not a conventional scientist. But these days, when more and more books are coming out relating and interconnecting science and spirituality, we need a new angle. We can no longer be told the old lies of the past. We need a new angle. We need new questions. We need to come together because, as people can see, not only the planetary threats, but I think the threat from governments are also getting more and more intense. And I think we need to regularly, maybe even in the future, talk about all of these subjects, and then, you know, people will spread this out. Don't forget, by the way, if you can put this on YouTube so that we can start, you know, getting you out there too, because you've been a fantastic interviewer and you've made me feel very comfortable that I can tell the truth on air.
Well, you know, that's my goal. I've been in media for many years, and you know, I'm always interested to hear what other people have to say, what their stories are, what is a driving force for them. And for you, of course, I take it that science is, technology is, world events are, but your insight to it, that to me is so fascinating as an interviewer. Because you are a very rare commodity when it comes to the people that I've interviewed that know what you know, even. They may know half of what you know, but, you know, I would much rather be able to have you back and be able to get into depth with even more things and the viewers, they're saying, yes, get him back. So, hey, guys, I'm trying
to
get
back. Well, that's great. That's great to hear. What I just want to leave everybody with saying is that, you know, I did mention that at one point I was angry with the Fukushima. What we have to do is we have to channel that anger first towards compassion, towards all the people being affected, and then we have to channel that anger into something constructive, something that we as individuals can make a difference. And I know that that's such a blatantly, you know, sort of overused phrase, that we as individuals can make a difference, but it is so true. I mean, just look at what we've accomplished in this 1 hour. And so I, you know, I just ask people just to think about this, get their questions lined up, and we, hopefully, you and I will go at this on a 2-hour amazing show.
It would be flawless, and you know what? It would be a great honor. You have no idea, because a lot
Thank
of the
you.
Things that the Occupy movement has stood for, stood against, other groups like what's happening in Turkey with the civil uprising that's going on there, what's been happening in Syria, and in, you know, just to name a couple of places around the globe, even a lot of the things that you have been saying have been so closely related to this, it is unbelievable. If people would just hear it and listen to what I'm hearing.
Exactly. You know, a lot of what's happening in the world nowadays is frightening a lot of people. We have so many disasters that are affecting people. And Robert, I'll just conclude. I know I've said this three or four times. It's almost like you know, I don't want to end this, but I think that you know, there's been so many things happening around the world. Most Americans think, well, it can never happen in the U.S. Well, you know, guess what? I mean, one of the topics that we can talk about maybe next time is the New Madrid Fault Zone. Or maybe we can talk about the record-breaking floods that are coming. Or how about that, you know, most people don't even know how cold it's going to get in the south in the next coming winter. So, you know, if people have this understanding that they can get an edge in different risk information, they can get prepared ahead of time, and I think that that's really important.
I completely agree with you. And you know what, Doctor? I cannot wait, trust me, to have you back on and do a full 2-hour show and just blow this thing out of the water. Because
let's
there,
do it.
There is, you know, in our chat, like I say, in our chat, we have, let me think. We have a nurse that is in there. We have somebody that works with a humane society for animals that is in there. We have somebody else that is a teacher in there. So you're able to finally connect the dots that a lot of people have been wondering and questioning and very angry about, and for good reason.
Well, that's it. And with the nurse on your show, Robert, essentially, you know, we could also tackle vaccinations and the number of toxins that the government actually puts in there to decrease our immune system, so that we have to rely more on the healthcare, which produces about 20% of the U.S. economy. If all of us were so healthy that our immune systems were impeccable, the U.S. economy would collapse. Now, obviously, that's in the current state of mind. But if we change that and we make sure that, you know, everything is for wellness, and people know that there's, you know, monkey's blood and there's sheep RNA and there's formaldehyde and there's aluminum that are all toxic in the vaccinations that we give to our kids, I think a lot of more people would be aware. And look, I'm not the only one that's saying this. There are MDs out there that have written books about the toxins in vaccinations. But it's just another subject that, again, we could discuss.
Well, you know, I tell you, a few years ago, I interviewed the Galloping Gourmet, the TV chef from the 70s, Graham Kerr. And I love Graham and Trina, his wife, to death. They're lovely people from Australia. Actually, they are Australian. But you know what? You are far more fascinating than Graham Kerr is.
No.
Oh, yes,
no,
you are.
Well, there's just so much. There's so much to discuss. And look, it's all interconnected vibrationally. All right, we are energetic beings, and I'm not putting religion into this. All right, I'm talking at a physics energetic level, and depending on where we live, and depending what we put into our bodies, it is changing our cellular energetics. And, you know, there may be some MDs out there that truthfully have no idea what I'm talking about, because they've learned in their process of getting their doctorate degrees that it's all about big pharma and the pill pushing and how toxic that is. And I think people are just waking up to really going natural and wondering about the universe and how we're connected and what can I do and what's my purpose and what's the meaning of life and so forth.
Well, Doctor, I tell you, I hate to cut it short, but we must. However, I do, of course, want to get you back, and I will send you messages on Twitter. I'll actually send you my email address. That way we can
lovely.
That way we can work on it and get you back on here in the near future.
Lovely. Thanks so much for having me, and a big blessing vibrationally to all of your audience out there, Robert. It has truly been spectacular. And as I say, keep me up to date with the vote, and based on that, we'll come together.
All right. Very good. Well, thank you once again so much.
Ciao. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Hey folks, what do you all think? That was the doctor, and you know what? I'm very, very, very happy about having the doctor on. Definitely, most definitely. All right, folks, we are now going to go back into what's going on right now, live, folks, in Turkey. So give me just a moment.